Hello, and welcome to another edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Today's video game based on a movie that we'll be reviewing is Last Action Hero, made by Sony ImageSoft in 1993 for the Super Nintendo Entertainment System. Last Action Hero is a 1993 Columbia Pictures released action, fantasy, adventure, comedy, mixed variety movie. The film got mostly mid-range reviews, with some finding the humor and situations to be unique and creative, while others just didn't seem to get what they were trying to accomplish all the way through, with its fantasy meets reality based plot. It was far from a huge success, making only $50 million in the United States in the theaters, and a dud in other markets outside of the US. Console and portable system versions were done by Sony ImageSoft. They were all different, but having the same feel in each version of them. The biggest star in the movie, of course, is Arnold Schwarzenegger, who has dual roles in the film, portraying main focal star of the films within the film, namely one Jack Slater, the everyman action police cop. He also portrays himself at various points, making a very interesting and unique way to be part of a movie. Arnold needs no introduction. The governor of California, who has been in countless films like Terminator and Predator and True Lies, just to name a few. Austin O'Brien portrays Danny Madigan, the energetic and Jack Slater movie-obsessed young focal point in the film. Austin has had a few roles in both movie and TV over the years, Lawnmower Man, Touched by an Angel, and Promised Land, and is still acting to this day. Filling out the rest of the movie stars are Art Carney from Honeymooners fame, portraying Frank, Robert Prosky portrayed movie theater owner Nick, and British actor Charles Dance as the main villain, Benedict. The movie revolves around two worlds, the world inside of the movies themselves and the real world that young school student Danny lives in, dreaming of nothing but his hero, Jack Slater, main hero from the films named after said character. Danny, one night while in the theater, is given a magic movie ticket by theater owner Nick. The movie ticket stub in Danny's pocket starts to glow, and before he can blink, he is suddenly trapped within the film. Now, Danny and Jack Slater get into all sorts of trouble together, while Danny tries to convince everybody that they're all in a movie the whole time. It's a romp between both worlds that has Jack meeting the actor who portrays him in the movie, and various lessons in the difference between real world and movie mechanics. There are a lot of great elements that could be portrayed well in a 16-bit video game world. Did they do it right, or does this get added to the long list of movie-to-video game disaster? Guess we're about to find out. On to the review. Just a quick note, the Genesis version of the game is very similar, following the same stages and same look to this version, which is minor aspects being altered. The game is mostly the same in every way, but I would say play the SNES version, as I did for this review, if you were to choose one, as it'll be a bit more user-friendly. The game will be your typical side-scrolling beat-em-up that many games in this time period seem to be set up as, with some driving moments mixed in to shake things up further. Upon turning the game on, you are greeted to a title screen that shows Arnold's name, as well as the movie title greeting us warmly to a very repetitive tune all the while. If you are brave enough to push start, it will go right into a cutscene moment that isn't even accurate to the story of the movie itself. Instead of Danny being teleported into the car as part of the chase, he is suddenly in front of a school, and Jack is going after the villain from the third movie. The only character you will have any control of for the entire game is, of course, Jack Slater himself, who will beat up any and every bad guy that comes in his way. There's only 6 stages in total found in the game, but don't let that low number fool you. It will be anything but easy to go from start to finish with the limited amount of lives that you are given for the whole entire game. 4 of the stages will be side-scrolling beat-em-up, with a boss found at the end of various stages that are cut into parts, whereas the other 2 are basic straightforward driving in car situations. As you enter the very first level after the cutscene, you will be in a typical side-scrolling situation, moving from left to right with the ability to punch, jump, and kick at the push of a button. At the top of the screen will be the gameplay information that you need to take note of. Most importantly is your green energy meter. Every time you get hit, you will lose a piece of it. Once it's fully depleted, you lose a life. Under Jack's name on the top of the screen will be the amount of lives you have left, and once those are down to 0, it's game over. There are no continues, so every life will count. Once it's game over, it's back to the start to do it all over again. There is the worthless score that is just for your own benefit, as it offers very little besides watching the numbers go up as you beat up would-be bad guys. And important to keep an eye on is the time limit. If that clock runs out, it's instant death, and back to the beginning of the stage again. Most of the times it won't be a problem, as it's straightforward, but there will be some close calls if you take too long at some of the moments. Jack Slater will only be able to perform hand-to-hand combat. He gets no weapons, no special abilities, and only one power-up to collect, that being a movie theater ticket icon that will restore some of his energy in the meter. Those will be vital to collect if you want to have any chance of getting through this game. The ticket icons will show up at the same exact moments every time you play, After you pass certain areas of the stage, they will fall from the sky, or they will be on ledges for you to jump to and get. All the first stage comes down to is, walk to the right, some enemies will walk onto the screen from the left and right side. You then have to either punch or kick them 6 or 7 times until they fade away and are knocked out, move on again to take on the next group, doing the same exact thing. Repeat, repeat, repeat to the end. That is all there is to it. So already, you're in for a real uncreative treat of very shallow and uninspiring gameplay. And sadly, no, it won't get much better from here. The enemies themselves are also shallow and uncreative. There are only 4, that's right, 4 enemies found on any of the 4 side-scrolling stages. And they don't change color, they don't change difficulty, they do the same exact things every single time you'll face them. Sony seems to have just made 4 sprites, and they used them for all they were worth. The enemies include knife stabbing guy, baseball bat swinging guy, Molotov cocktail throwing guy, and gun shooting thug. The same jean jacket, red cap, metal bat holding thug from the first stage is the same exact one on the later stages. Not only is this the most monotonous, uninspiring, and laziest way to do a game such as a beat 'em up, it also has nothing to do with anything in the film at all. The gun firing guys at least make some sense as to what he had to deal with, but the rest just seems a bit of a stretch. Now once you get past the fact that the enemies will be exactly the same, defeating them is a whole other problem that you have to deal with. Fighting these 4 enemies that show up is a nightmare at many times. The enemies as they show up will oftentimes walk right through you, making hit detection horrible. You can punch and kick about and not connect any of those moves, but they will suddenly hit you, knocking you about as they all suddenly are ganging up on you. That you can even deal with, as if you play long enough you'll get used to when you can start hitting them. But the punch and kick that your character has for his use is terrible. The punch will be slightly faster, so you'll want to resort to that, as the kick actually seems to be a second slower to react than the punches. They would walk right through your slow kick attack due to the poor hit detection, and next thing you know you are being beat up very quickly. It would never get any better at any time during the game, and even once you get used to it, it's the same thing over and over and over again. Punch, 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 back away. Jump over bad guy. Duck past the shot fired, punch, 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 knock him out. Do the same thing all over again. At the end of these fighting stages, you will confront a boss. The bosses at least all do relate to the film in some way, and even match up well enough to the situation where he was fighting them. He will face Ripper twice, a helicopter, similar to the scene in the movie, and of course, final boss of the game, Benedict. The boss battles actually were not that difficult, as surprising as that is. I found all 4 boss battles to be quite simplistic and over before they even started. Ripper I just kept hitting as he came close, finishing him off simply enough. The copter situation is just punchback rockets flying back at you while avoiding some other bullets also coming at you, and even Benedict himself was pretty simplistic. They put no effort at all into making for interesting boss battles. It's very unrewarding to go through all that and then beat up on a simple boss, only to have to repeat all that again on the next stage. The other 2 stages found in the game are driving-based ones. In the first driving-based stage, you will be driving in Jack's brown car from the film. This stage is another one that will have repeat enemy syndrome, with you coming across waves and waves of the same-looking enemies all throughout the stage. The stage is long, and there are instant-kill obstacles that will really frustrate you, especially since you have to start all over again if you do lose a life on this stage as well. While driving, you will have ramps to jump over and leap over parked oil tanker trucks. If you hit any tanker or parked car, it's instant death. Also, the only way to defeat other enemies on the road is by leaping on said ramps and landing down upon them. The driving stages will be long and repetitive and annoying, but they are pretty straightforward, and at least that is something other than the even worse fighting stage. As you could probably see by the game's play in this review, the graphics aren't anything that spectacular. Very basic, no-frill backgrounds. Worst of all is the character that is supposed to be Arnold Schwarzenegger looks nothing like him. To me, it looked like Craig T. Nelson from the Coach TV show. The cutscenes themselves are very short and to the point, and will sort of tie things into the movie, but very loosely, if at all. The game, of course, will end as you have an unrelated to the film final confrontation in the movie theater with Benedict. He will throw some orbs around you that you can easily avoid. The end also was changed drastically. It's a very basic, generic goodbye ending with the hero and kid parting ways. They couldn't even get the ending right. I would be embarrassed to have my name show up on the credits of this game. That's just awful. It's not even that none of the songs were in the film. It's that the soundtrack for this game seems to be done by someone who had this thing for repetitive riffs over and over again. Every single stage just has this constant beat of sorts repeating constantly, and it's not enjoyable at any moment. The music, though, fits because, like the game, it was repetitive, non-stop, repeating over and over again as you fight the same exact guys over and over again. This is one magic movie ticket that you won't want to go anywhere near. It's games like this that really give movie-based games the bad rep that they do deserve. There's very little, if anything, redeeming or fun to be found at any point in this adventure. Most won't even get past the first level, and others that do won't care to go further in the game, as it has very little to offer in the means of fun or excitement. Bosses are easier than the rest of the game. Start back at the beginning of a level when you die. You have limited lives, and on and on and on. Just everything you can do wrong in a game was done here. This is certainly one of the worst games out there based on a movie. And even if you do wind up getting through this game, you will never pick it up again. Some will find it not as hard as others, but I don't think any will say that this dud was worth the time spent on it. See the film again if you need more Last Action Hero in your life. But as for the game, avoid, avoid, avoid. This terrible game gets a... That's all for this edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Please be sure to check back soon for our next video game based on a movie review.